Good morning. It is now an echo. Okay. My distinct honor to introduce our first keynote speaker, Captain Charlie Plum. After graduating from the Naval Academy, Captain Charlie Plum completed Navy flight training and reported to Miramar Naval Air Station in San Diego, where he flew the first adversarial flights in the development of what would be called the Navy Fighter Weapons School, currently known as Top Gun. The next year, Plum's squadron, the Aardvarks, launched on the aircraft carrier USS Kitty Hawk with Fighter Squadron 114 to fly the F-4 Phantom Jet. Captain Plum flew 74 successful combat missions over North Vietnam and made over 100 carrier landings. On his 75th mission, just 5 days before the end of his tour, Captain Plum was shot down over Hanoi, taken prisoner, tortured, and spent the next 2,103 days in North Vietnamese prisoner of war camps. His first prison cell was 8 feet long and 8 feet wide. During his nearly 6 years of captivity, Plum distinguished himself as a pro in underground communications. Following his repatriation, Plum continued his Navy flying career in reserve squadrons. His last two commands as a naval reservist were on the aircraft carrier and at a fighter air wing in California. He retired from the United States Navy with the rank of captain after 31 years of service. His awards include the Silver Star, 2 Purple Hearts, and the POW Medal. Since his return home, Plum has captivated more than 5,000 audiences in almost every industry around the world with stories that parallel his POW experience with the challenges of everyday life. To show you how it all began, let's watch this video.
The prison cell I was in Vietnam was 8 feet long and 8 feet wide. I remember distinctly the dimensions of that little cell. I could pace 3 steps in one direction before I ran into a wall. Then I had the opportunity of turning around and pacing 3 steps the other way. Inside my new little cell, I had nothing to do. I had no books to read, no window to look out, no TV, telephone, BlackBerry, Bluetooth. I didn't have a pencil or a piece of paper. For 2,103 days, to give you a better feel for that window of time, 2,103 days equates to age 24 to age 30 in my life. Turn your calendar ahead to the year 2027. Consider between today and 2027 the books you'll read, courses you'll take, jobs you'll have, things you'll do. Pretty good chunk out of a guy's life. Now, I've been a very active guy, like each of you, on the go all the time, searching for an extra 15 minutes a week to call my mom. Suddenly, I had 24 hours a day for the next nearly 6 years. I'm describing this scenario to you somewhat semi-dramatically because I think the most value I can be in this leadership conference, the most value I can be in your life, professionally and personally, military, civilian, whether you consider yourself a leader right now or not, the most value I can be is to invite you into my little cell. There's a great deal to be learned about leadership in a prison cell. So for the next few moments, I'd like for you to try your best to smell the stench of that imaginary 2-gallon bucket in the corner I call my toilet. I'd like for you to try to feel the baking heat of a tropical summer in a tin roof prison cell 10,000 miles away from the good life. I'd like for you to try to taste the salt, the annoying taste of salt in the corners of your mouth from the sweat and the tears and the blood. Not that you'll ever be prisoners of war, God forbid. But if I do my job, you'll see where the same kinds of challenges you and I face on a daily basis are the challenges that I faced in that prison cell. And more importantly, your response to the challenge, if you're going to succeed, has to be the very same recipe of responses I used over there just to survive. And what's the leadership angle of all this? Well, let me begin with a little quiz, all right? Let's say your boss, your commanding officer, the soup, or the president of your university pulls you into the office and says, close the door. I have a mission for you. I'd like for you to go to a deserted island in the middle of nowhere. You can't communicate with me or anybody else from this island. I'm going to give you 200 people to accomplish a mission. These 200 people, well, you can't fire them. You can't hire anybody new. You can't motivate them with money or vacations. You can't give them a Friday afternoon off. In fact, you can't even see them. And the only way you can communicate with your 200 people are by tapping on a wall or tugging on a wire in a very cumbersome code that takes days to get your thoughts across. Here's the quiz. What kind of leadership talent do you have that you would pull out and apply to a challenge like that? Well, if you haven't already guessed, that's the challenge that Admiral James Bond Stockdale had when he was shot down over North Vietnam. One of the finest leaders I have ever known had no stick, no carrot. His leadership principles, as the Admiral just told you, keep us safe, keep us valued, keep us respected, and find a purpose in all of this. Very, very simple. Or in a new vernacular, I'd like to suggest this little ditty for you. You gotta be able to pack parachutes. Let me explain that. I sat down in a restaurant several years after I came back from the prison camps of North Vietnam. About two tables over, a guy kept looking at me. I caught his glance, but I didn't recognize this gent. He stood up. This fellow walked over to my table. He pointed at me with a very serious look on his face. He said, "You're Captain Plum." I looked up and I said, "Well, yes, sir, I'm Captain Plum." "You're that guy? You flew jet fighters in Vietnam. You're a fighter pilot, part of that Top Gun outfit in Miramar. You were shot down flying an F-4 Phantom. You parachuted into enemy hands. You spent 6 years as a prisoner of war." Somewhat dumbfounded, I looked up at this guy and I said, "How in the world do you know all that?" He finally broke into a smile and he said, "Because I packed your parachute." I tell you this, But this guy that runs around the country making speeches, suddenly I was speechless. Best I could do was stagger to my feet, reach out a very grateful hand of thanks. He came up with just the proper words. The guy grabbed my hand, he pumped my arm, and he said, "I guess it worked." I say, indeed it did, my friend. And I must tell you, I've said a lot of prayers of thanks for your nimble fingers, but I had no idea I'd ever have the opportunity of expressing my gratitude in person. He said, "Were all the panels there?" I said, "I appreciate your interest, and I must be honest with you, no, they weren't. Of the 18 panels I was supposed to have in that parachute, I had only 15 good ones. Three of the panels were torn. But it wasn't your fault, it was mine. I ejected from that Phantom jet at 600 knots close to the ground. I was well outside the envelope of that parachute. You did your job, I didn't do mine." I said, "But let me ask you a question. Do you keep track of all the parachutes you pack? Do you know of all the lives you've saved?" The guy said, "No." Now, this is the most important part of the conversation. Maybe the most important thing I say to you today. I think it deals directly with the very vision of this Naval Academy Leadership Conference. I think it deals directly with your being a leader. Here's what he said. He said, "Now, I don't keep track of all the parachutes I pack. It's enough gratification for me just to know that I've served." Here's a sailor, well below the waterline of this aircraft carrier, okay? His job is to stand at a long wooden table. He weaves the shrouds and he folds the silk panels of these parachutes. Passes them along, one after another, 8, 10, 12, 14 hours a day, while the jet jockey, while the Top Gun zooms around the sky at the speed of sound, couldn't have cared less about the guy down there in the hole. Until one day my parachute came along. And he saved my life. And he packed mine up for me. Does that compute with your brand of leadership to be a servant leader? Does that equate to keeping your people safe, to value your people, to respect your people? Or is the whole idea just to get the job done? Well, I got to tell you this, didn't take me very many miles, three steps to one, three steps the other in that prison cell. I was going nuts. I finally decided, "Charlie, if you're going to survive this, you're going to have to come up with something to do, make a little game to play, get creative here." I thought, "That's what I'll do. I'll make a little deck of cards." And I did. I constructed a little deck of playing cards about the size of postage stamps. I tore these cards from 52 little strips of toilet paper. And I learned this in that prison camp. Toilet paper is tough to shuffle. You don't lick your finger very much shuffling to it. Okay, before we get back into the prison scene and the connection, the leadership connection between my life and yours, let me tell you what respect I have of being back here at Annapolis. Yep, been a few years since I was here. Farm kid from Kansas, never seen the ocean, never ridden in an airplane, knew nothing about the Navy or the military. But I stood on the bricks of Tecumseh Court in Bancroft Hall, just like many of you have done, and I pledged to defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic. What a commitment that was. And I had no idea what it was going to take to fulfill that commitment. I learned a lot here. Learned to tie knots in the Morse code, drive the boats around the Chesapeake Bay. Got a degree in engineering. Lucky for me, I got my parachute packed. Here's the thing about parachute packing, okay? See, sometimes you really don't even realize that your parachute is packed. And I think that if there's one thing I'd like to get across to you, because the fact is not lost on me, that you and I are three generations apart. Your language, your humor, your music, your lifestyle is so far from mine, and yet The basics of leadership go back thousands of years. But here's what I'd like to get across. The things I learned here at the Naval Academy and throughout my earlier life, I had no idea what all this stuff meant. When I pledged to defend the Constitution, I had no idea what that meant. And Reef Points. For those of you non-Naval Academy folks, Reef Points is a little book. Reef Points are the points of a sail, okay, where you reef the sail. You take part of the sail down in storms. So Reef Points is a little book that tells you how to deal with storms, all right? And I was forced to memorize a lot of that Reef Points. I didn't think at the time it would ever make any sense. But because I was a plebe, I memorized Reef Points. And one of the things that kept coming back to me over and over and over in the various leadership positions that I have had, and especially in that prison camp, was the qualifications of a naval officer. Attributed at the time, we thought it was John Paul Jones. Well, later it turns out to be kind of a rendition of how Jones led in the various fights that he was in. Here's what it says. It is by no means enough that an officer of the Navy be a capable mariner. He must be that, of course, but also a great deal more. He should be as well a gentleman of liberal education, refined manners, punctilious courtesy, and the nicest sense of personal honor. He should be the soul of tact, patience, justice, firmness, kindness, and charity. No meritorious act of any subordinate should escape his attention or be left without its reward, even if that reward is a word of approval. Conversely, he must be quick and unfailing to distinguish error from malice, thoughtlessness from incompetency, and well-meant shortcomings from heedless or stupid blunder. Wow, and those were just words to me at the Naval Academy. And Invictus, you know that poem? That's the one I learned here too. Out of the night that covers me, dark as a pit from pole to pole, I thank whatever gods may be for my inconquerable soul. In the fell clutch of circumstance, I have not winced nor cried aloud. Under the bludgeonings of chance, my head is bloody, but unbowed. Beyond this place of human tears lies but the shadow of the shade, that's death. And yet the menace of the years finds and shall find me unafraid. It matters not how straight the gate, how filled with punishments the soul. I am the master of my fate. I am the captain of my soul. But let's go back to Jones. Let's put this in your perspective. And let's bring it up to date, okay? Let's say it's by no means enough that a leader should be capable, right? That means it's good to be educated, all right? But also a great deal more. That leader should be the soul of tact, patience, justice, firmness, and charity. The leader should be able to distinguish error from malice, thoughtlessness from incompetency, and well-meant shortcomings from heedless or stupid blunder. And so I graduated from this school. And Alexis told you I went to flight training, married my high school sweetheart under the Arch of Swords. What a beautiful day for that wedding, right straight to flight training. Went through Pensacola, Florida, Beeville, Texas, Meridian, Mississippi, where John McCain was my flight instructor. Out to San Diego, where I flew the first adversarial flights for the Top Gun school. Exciting times. Left my wife on her birthday. Stood on that flight deck, and I looked down at the pier, Pier 3 at North Island, and waved to her and promised I'd be back in 8 months. Another commitment that was tough to fulfill. 74 successful combat missions, over 100 carrier landings. Check this out. 24 years old. farm kid from Kansas, in command of a multi-gazillion dollar jet fighter. See this hand? I have two throttles in this hand. I shove these throttles into the afterburner so I can go 1,400 miles an hour, and that's a long way from a John Deere. See this pinky, my finger here? Pull the trigger on my control stick. I can release the missiles from underneath my Phantom. I can knock down enemy airplanes I can't even see. Really, I'm the top gun. I am the best of the best. I'm the guy that always stands tall. You know, the one that's never afraid. Hey, I'm probably bulletproof. Ever feel bulletproof? Here's the advice. When you start feeling bulletproof, check your 6 o'clock position. You got a missile sneaking up your tail. We were hit. My radar intercept officer, my co-pilot in the back seat, hit by a surface-to-air missile, exploded to some 12,000 pounds of jet fuel, sent that bird topsy-turvy, end over end, down towards the rice paddy below. I ejected. He ejected. Our parachutes opened, and we came floating down over enemy territory. Ever been in one of those parachutes? But I don't mean the nylon ones. I'm talking about those parachutes of life. You see, that's what leadership is about. The parachutes that your people will have, and not the physical ones. I'm convinced that something as insignificant as being cut out of your lane on the freeway, something as major as the loss of a loved one, can be just as detrimental in the lives of the people that depend on you for leadership as it was in mine. And so I felt the opening shock. Looked up, counted the panels of my parachute. Looked down, they're shooting at me. The audacity, don't they know I'm the top gun? Don't they know I'm bulletproof? Look, they've just knocked down my multi-gazillion dollar jet fighter, and now they're shooting at the pilot. And I'll tell you this, now when you're dodging bullets, it's tough to come up with a long-range plan. So what do you do? I don't know. All I can tell you is what I did. I took a deep breath as that gunny taught me across the river in the rifle range. I let about half of it out, tried to calm myself, and I bowed my head, and I said a prayer. Ask for a little extra strength that day from above. And then I prayed for my wife. Remember? See, this was my war, not hers, and yet at the end of the Vietnam War, she would feel more pain from that war than I did. Hit the ground, sunk about waist deep in a rice paddy, descended upon by, it seemed like, a gazillion of the enemy. They stripped me of everything I had. They took my flight gear, my clothing, my personal possessions. They even took my name. They gave me a name from their language just to humiliate me for the next nearly 6 years. Dragged me around village to village, tortured for 2 days with ropes and irons and whips. After 2 days of that torture, they tossed me into this little cell. The one I described to you from the very beginning. Well, you learn a lot in a prison cell, and the first thing you learn is pain. This hurts. You figure that out. Second thing, you might not suspect this. The second thing you learn in a prison cell is, well, the seconds eventually wear into minutes. I mean, it takes forever for the minutes to become hours, and then hours to become days, and man alive, with nothing to do 24/7. Well, it's sort of like COVID and the lockdown. And then the weeks turn into months and months, and you acclimate. You know, you get used to this. You learn how to breathe deeply and think about things far away, thoughts of home and the future, and you plan out your life, and you know what happens? You get used to this. You really do. In fact, you get so comfortable in your 8-foot by 8-foot cell that the last place you want to go is outside the cell because it's dark and lonely out here. At least you know the devil in the light. Here's what happens. You get this restriction built up. And it's not the 8 feet between the walls. It's the 8 inches between your ears. You're in a mental box. And this is a mental game. Ever been in one of those mental boxes? Yeah, we all get there. So that's where I was, in my little mental box. And I'm feeling sorry for myself. And I'm feeling very guilty. See, I'd failed my mission so miserably, failed. I tried to be strong. I tried to stick with the name, rank, serial number, date of birth. I'd been taught, you know, at survival school. I knew the military code of conduct. And I thought I'd be strong, but I wasn't. And so I am in this mental funk, okay? I'm in this place of guilt and regret. How can I ever go home to my wife and my friends and my fellow fighter pilots, man, admit to them that I'd fail so miserably? And that was the bad news. So I'm pacing along, and I heard in the far corner the chirping noise of a cricket. I paid no attention at first, yet the longer I listened, the more rhythmic this chirp became, and I thought, that's a pretty educated little critter. I walked over to the corner of my prison cell, and I found there no cricket, but a little piece of wire was about that long, poked through a hole at the base of the cell wall and scratching on my concrete floor, making this chirping noise like a cricket. I'm watching the little wire. Here's what I'm thinking. The enemy is not sophisticated enough to try to trick me. So on the other end of that wire has to be a prisoner of war, an American. If it's a POW, it's got to be a pilot, like me. Boy, would I like to talk to another pilot. Boy, we can tell some stories. But I'll bet that guy's tougher than I am. He's probably older. He's probably higher rank. Probably more mature. Probably a better pilot. And worst of all, he probably didn't spill his guts when they tortured him like I did. I am losing interest now. It would be nice to talk to somebody else about my situation, but hey, life's pretty short, got other things to do. Anyway, if I crawl over here in the corner of this prison cell and wait, surely in a few years the Marines will break down the gates and I'll be set free. I'll never have to take another risk the rest of my life. And it took me a couple of hours sweating bullets till I finally got up the guts to reach down and grab that little wire and tug. And the wire tugged back. I tugged again and it disappeared right back through that rat hole. But it came back about an hour later. This time the wire had a note wrapped around the end of it. The note was written on a dirty piece of toilet paper in ink made from ashes or brick dust. I could barely make it out, but it said, "Memorize this code, then eat this note." I did it. I memorized the code. I ate the note. This code is a 5x5 matrix of the alphabet. 5 lines, 5 rows. A, B, C, D, E across the top. F, G, H, I, J. We left out K to make it come out even. Numbers down the side across the top, indicating any letter of the alphabet would be represented by 2 numbers. Number of the line, then a number of the row. Got it? A, first line, first row, 1 tug, 1 more tug. Z, fifth line, fifth. You think your email is cumbersome. You try this. But it worked. This silly, archaic, cumbersome code became our language. More than that, it became our lifeblood. It was absolutely vital. I mean, life and death, vital that we communicate with the other prisoners. Here's the interesting part. Wasn't the words. Nope. Wasn't the phrases. Wasn't the sentences. It wasn't the data. The life-saving property of communication in a prison camp and in your world as a leader is not the words. The life-saving property is the simple validation of another human being. That's what communication is all about. It's about letting your people know that they are safe, that they are valued, that they are respected. Oh, here's the interesting part. See, you and I would probably argue in this high-tech world that the greatest achievement of all times is we can now pass a packet of data around the world at lightning speed to another little machine. And yet, I'm convinced that your value is validating other people. In those prison cells, when it was dark, and you were in solitary confinement. Some guys were in solitary confinement for 4.5 years. That's Admiral Jeremiah Denton. What happens is you lose track. When it's dark and you're alone, you can't tell green from red, and you can't talk to anybody, and it's 24/7 of no inputs. You lose track. You don't know what's a real memory, what's a hallucination of a memory. You need a baseline. You need to validate your sanity. You need some feedback. The simple tugging on a wire and have that wire tug back. Then two things. Number one, somebody's responding to something I'm doing physically, thus I exist. Number two, somebody values me and cares. Well, it got to the point. If a guy was put in a prison cell on the far side of the camp, could not communicate with the rest of us, the guy probably wasn't going to make it. So, on the other end of my little wire, I was communicating with Bob Shoemaker, fighter pilot extraordinaire, astronaut candidate, better than that. Here's a parachute packer. Don't miss the metaphor. Somebody who would give of himself, asking nothing in return. For my benefit. He'd been there for 2 years when I showed up. A total of 8 years for Bob Shoemaker. He'd been piecing together little bits of wire, stuffing them out a hole in his cell wall across a storeroom. There was a storeroom between our two prison cells. Over the boxes, around the shovels, through the ropes, into the little hole in my cell wall, 14 feet away. Unbelievable. Just to contact another American. Just to pack my parachute. He said, "How you doing, buddy?" I said, "I'm doing terrible, buddy." He said, "My president sent me over here. It's his dirty Vietnam War, not mine. It's not fair what's going on in my life. I'm the victim of circumstances beyond my control. And the enemy's torturing prisoners. They signed the Geneva Convention and not abiding by it. It's not fair what's going on in my life, but it's not my fault. I'm just a victim of circumstances beyond my control. And it was not my private airplane I flew in here, you know. That was a U.S. government airplane. Said so right on the tail. Congress bought it. I didn't. They should be here. I should not. This whole thing is going, it's not fair what's going on in my life. Man, I got this lockdown thing. I can't go to the baseball games. I can't go to the movies. I can't even go get outside the yard anymore. And I'm eating from these plastic plates with plastic spoons, and it's not fair what's going on in my life. But it's not my fault. I am the victim of circumstances beyond my," Shoemaker said. "You want to know your biggest problem?" I said, "You mean I have problems bigger than the ones I can see?" "Sound like you're suffering from a fairly common prison disease. Most guys get it. Some guys die from it." "Oh man, what's the name of this disease?" He said, "Around here we just call it prison thinking." I said, "Prison thinking?" He said, "Roger, you think you're a prisoner." I dropped the wire. I stepped back in that cell. I am still bleeding from 4 open wounds, so I had no medical care. Got all these boils all over my body, all over my face. I haven't really had a full meal to eat in months. Clearly, I'm rotting away in this communist prison camp. And now, to add insult to injury, they put me next to a positive thinker. I said, "Okay, I guess I have a bad case of this prison thinking." He said, "Well, let me tell you this." He said, "You're not going to believe this at first, but you have just joined the finest team you'll ever play on." He said, "We have leadership in this prison camp that's beyond even anybody's imagination. The best leaders you will ever see, you will find in this prison camp." They can't talk to us. They can't restrict our liberty. But you will find that they have been and continue to be the finest leaders you will ever see. He said, our senior man, Admiral James Bond Stockdale, we call him CAG, he was commander of the air group, said, he's turned this thing around. He said, we're not on the defensive. We're not being put upon. We are warriors, and we will pursue this war till our last dying breath. Well, I'll tell you, I was a JG at the time, okay? I'm looking around in that prison cell, okay? I've got rats and snakes and bugs, and I mean, it is a filthy, filthy place. I'm bleeding from several places on my body. I'm wondering if I'm ever going to go home, and he's telling me, you know, that I've just joined this great team. I got to tell you, I didn't believe it at first. I said, okay, Shoemaker, tell me about this leadership we've got. He said, they've given us a purpose. That sound familiar? One of Admiral Buck's principles, give him a purpose, okay? Make it a realistic purpose. Don't make it up. And if you can't think of it, you know, just you know, sit back, take 15 minutes in silence and you will realize your purpose. And if you're military, there's no question what your purpose is. Okay? His purpose was a three-word motto. That's it. Three words. That's pretty simple. Here are the three words of Stockdale's motto, return with honor. I helped commission a ship 4 years ago. Took my wife and one of my sons down to San Diego, and we rode that ship up to Port Hueneme, where we commissioned the ship. The ship is called the USS Stockdale. And right on the bow is the motto, return with honor. I got to tell you that as a JG, I'm thinking, oh, great. Oh, and then he says, oh, and Stockdale and the other leadership in this prison camp, they've come up with a bunch of rules we got to follow. Rules? What are you going to do? You going to pull my Liberty card? No, he said, here are the rules. We want you to memorize these rules. And I'm thinking to myself, oh, yeah, okay, yeah, okay, here are the powers that be now. All of my senior officers now are going to put further restrictions on me. And I found that kind of discipline gave me more freedom than ever before. Okay, what are the rules? He said, well, this is the conduct of a prisoner of war. He said, we've redefined the code of conduct, and here's what it is. He said, we have several levels of resistance that we use. The highest level of resistance is a prison outbreak. Okay, that's when we start strangling the guards. Okay, that's pretty serious. But the five steps up to are various stages. The first level of restriction, the first thing that we do, okay, when Stockdale says, okay, we're going into level one, that means that you refuse to bow to the enemy. That was one of the things we were forced to do, okay? Every time you saw a guard, anytime they came to your door and opened the little flap in your door and looked in, you had to come to the door and give them a very low, ceremonious bow as your respect, okay? And if you didn't do that, you were beaten because you didn't bow. And that's the first level. Sounds pretty insignificant, doesn't it? And yet, what that did, when Stockdale put out the, okay, level one, and everybody refused to bow. See, they didn't know we were communicating with each other in the prison camp. And so you got 300 people in a prison camp, and suddenly, to a man, we refused to bow. It scared them to death that we had that kind of unity. And what did it do to us? It gave us a great feeling of strength. Yeah, we didn't have our airplanes anymore. You know, we didn't have our missiles anymore, but we still had power. What a feeling that was. So, Admiral Stockdale and Jeremiah Denton and John McCain. Now, John McCain was my flight instructor. In fact, I went to school here in the same company with Joe McCain, John's brother. So I knew the great naval tradition of the McCain family. I served under his father, Admiral J.S. McCain. And I knew that John and Joe's grandfather was an admiral in World War II, and you all know that history. So I knew the great naval tradition of the McCain family. Well, I was in a prison camp called the Plantation. I'm peeking through a crack in my door. I could see the personnel gate. Into the personnel gate comes two guards on two ends of a stretcher. On the stretcher laid out there was a fighter pilot. This was not unusual. I couldn't see his face, but an arm over the side, and his hand was green and gray, and I thought that rigor mortis might have already set in. The guy might be dead. They stuffed him in cell 3. I was in cell 1 in that particular prison camp. And so I got on the wall with the guys next door, and I said, I'm tapping now on the wall. I'm saying, a guy just moved in next door, and he's hurting, and he may not make it. You better bring him around. Communicate with a new man. They tried for weeks to communicate. Nothing. Each day we saw bloody rags coming out of that cell, and we knew he was still alive. And then into the prison camp came a pair of shears, the old hand clippers. That was always bad news. That meant that a prisoner was going to be cleaned up to see a delegation. We were forced to see the likes of Jane Fonda and Ramsey Clark, and guys were tortured to tell delegations that the treatment was good. Crazy thing. They took the clippers into cell 3, the new guy. Next day, I'm peeking through my crack in the door. Could barely see outside cell 3. A big pile of white hair. I mean, like silvery white hair. We were all in our 20s and early 30s. Just weren't very few guys that were prematurely gray. I'm thinking to myself, oh, man. There's only one guy in the Navy I know of that's got hair like that. My old flight instructor's been shot down. John McCain. Well, still couldn't verify that. Until one day, I get outside my cell with my bucket going towards the sewer house. Now, this cell 3 was right across the path from the sewer house. And as I walked in, I let the guard get a little ahead of me. And as I passed cell 3, I whistled anchors away. Dumped my bucket, came back through very faintly from inside cell 3. I could hear anchors away. And it was, in fact, John McCain. And one of the toughest guys in that prison camp was John McCain. But maybe the best parachute packer of all turned out to be a Navy sailor, an enlisted guy. Wait a minute, Captain. You just told us that you're all fighter pilots and you're all officers. How did a sailor get into a prison camp in an air war over North Vietnam? Well, he fell off his ship. He used to tell us, I wasn't captured like you pilots. I was rescued. And indeed he was, 19 years old. Seaman Douglas Hegdahl from Clark, South Dakota, on the fantail of the cruiser Canberra. Middle of the night, ship's doing inshore fire support. And he gets outside and he falls off the rail, got washed ashore. But could he take a joke? We'd have these contests just for something to do. We would tug on our wires and tap on our walls and pass around a questionnaire. Who's the oldest in the prison camp? Who's got the most kids back home? Who's been here the longest? One time we had what we call the high fast, low slow contest to try to determine what fighter pilot had jumped out of his jet going highest and fastest. Who jumped out going lowest and slowest? High fast contest is won by some Air Force jock who punched out of his F-105 at 52,000 feet, 1,000 miles an hour. And the low slow contest was won by the Navy sailor. 12 feet at 15 knots, right there. Oh, but here's the interesting part, and why I take your valuable time to tell you his story. This lowest ranking, insignificant, entry level, you know, part-timer, non-person-person, didn't seem to suffer from this 8-inch box. He didn't have a bad case of prison thinking, like the more mature of us college graduate leaders of the world did. What did he do? Hegdahl kicked down what was left of his comfort zone, got further outside himself, started tugging on wires and tapping on walls. He began by memorizing all the names of all the prisoners, 254 of us in that camp. Put those names into songs, sang these songs over and over. Went back through the list, memorized our identifier or social security number, 254 different long numbers. Unbelievable. Still wasn't finished. He then went back through his list and he memorized our next of kin and their hometowns all across the country. And finally, I'm not kidding you, Hegdahl memorized the telephone numbers of each of the relatives of each of the prisoners. That took 2 years. About that time, things were improving, and the enemy decided to, as proof of their lenient and humane treatment, they're going to send some guys home early before the end of the war. Our senior man, Dick Stratton, sent the message to the sailor, "Son, I want you to volunteer to go home first." The sailor sent back, "Sir, with all due respect, I'd rather stay here with the team. I want to march home with you guys." Talk about a culture. The culture we developed in that prison camp meant that every man there was dedicated to return with honor. They were going to go home in order of sick and injured, enlisted, and then pilot by shoot down date. Every man in that prison camp was destined, was almost blinded with this purpose that we had. That's the kind of culture you want to create. So he finally said, Hegdahl finally said, "Okay, yes, sir, I'll go home." And he came home. Now write the script on this sailor. What can you expect of a sailor imprisoned 2 years by accident? He's been starved, humiliated, lonely, tortured. Hasn't seen a woman in 2 years, and suddenly he's got 2 years back pay in his pocket, and he's free on the streets of Baltimore. Oh, did I tell you he was a parachute packer? Oh, I suppose he did. Sure, he began to travel. He went west coast to east. He went north to south. He went through each one of the hometowns he'd memorized. He dialed each one of those telephone numbers he'd memorized. He spoke to each one of the wives he'd memorized and told her that her prisoner was alive. How about it? You know those folks I'm talking about, those parachute packers? Yep, they're in your units, okay? And you will see them in your careers going forward. Sometimes they're hard to recognize, you know? You know, back to trying to distinguish between error and malice, okay? Back to trying to figure out just, what's the motivation of that particular person in doing that particular thing? But they're there. If you look for them and you nurture them, you can build the finest team you'll ever play on. The war ended, we traded prisoners. 591 of us and 10,000 of them. Flew out of there in a big C-141. Clark Air Force Base, ran down the ladder, crossed the tarmac to the first telephone I could find. You would have too. But she was gone. Called my parents. Said, "Well, she hung on for 5 years, and just 3 months ago, your wife filed for divorce. She's engaged to another guy." And then my thought process goes to, yep, this is another tough issue. But I am convinced, and I think I'm living proof, that adversity is a horrible thing to waste. That if I decide myself, okay, that I am the master of my fate. I am the captain of my soul. I can make decisions. I can't control what's around me, but I can certainly control the way I respond to what's around me. So I got on with my life. wrote a book about my life. My autobiography is called I'm No Hero. And I was promote that book, and I started to travel and speak, and found that yes. And I'm not the only one with this. 591 of us came home. They thought we'd be in baskets. They thought we'd be vegetables. They thought we'd be zombies. They had our families briefed to institutionalize us the rest of our lives. So far, from 591 men, we have produced 17 generals and 7 admirals. Most of us retired as senior grade military officers. We went back to flying airplanes and commanding ships and fleets and battalions all across the world. We have a bunch of congressmen, 2 United States senators from our number, 2 ambassadors from our number. We have doctors and lawyers and preachers and teachers and bishops and judges and a vice presidential candidate and a presidential candidate from 591 men. The last time I was at Annapolis, I was burying one of those guys, John McCain. Walked behind his casket over to the cemetery. So this is the heritage, okay, that you have to support and defend. My ex-wife married the guy she was engaged to. I remarried a wonderful lady. We have 4 kids and 4 grandkids. And they live a very, very happy life. And I ran a marathon a few years ago in Alaska. It's called the Midnight Sun Run. Saturday, closest to the longest day of the year. I chose that marathon because I figure I might need 24 hours of daylight to run 26 miles. Took 2 of my kids up there with me. Joe and Evie went. Night before the race, I'm talking to my kids. Hey, this is your dad's craziness, and I don't want to impose on your vacation. So tomorrow morning, it's an early go. I don't even know where this race is, but I'll find it. Don't worry. Sleep in, take it easy, have a leisurely breakfast, and I'll be back tomorrow afternoon. It was a hot day in Anchorage, 83 degrees. Whew, I hadn't trained for that. And the hills, I hadn't trained for those. And I'm about halfway through, and you runners in the crowd know, hitting the wall, man. I hit the wall about mile 13. I'm chugging along there, barely putting 1 foot in front of the other, thinking to myself, the most beautiful sight in the world is going to be that finish sign, but it wasn't. It was under the... Here's Joe, Evie, 2 of my kids cheering on the old man when I finally caught my breath. I went to my kids, and you just don't know how much it means to me to have you here, but how did you find the finish line? Well, Dad, we shared a cab with a couple of guys in the hotel. They knew where it was. I said, how did they know where it was? Well, Dad, they ran the race. They came back to the hotel. They had breakfast. They swam a few laps. They showered. And we came back to see you finish. Okay, let's stop for some questions. I'm open to anything. I'm a very transparent man. So don't ask any question you're afraid of the answer.
One virtual question from Midshipman Nicholas Lewis, Cadet Master, Maine Maritime Academy. In the most dire situations, what can someone do as a leader to motivate themselves and, most importantly, their team?
In dire situations, what can a leader do to motivate themselves and, more importantly, their team? Well, first of all, and I've already said it, and the Admiral said it as well, find a purpose. Here's the good news, okay? In dire situations, there's always a purpose. And frequently, that purpose is very clear, right? But as a leader, you have to restate the purpose. You have to live the purpose. You have to breathe and sleep the purpose. And if you can do that, and then communicate that to your people, they pick up on this purpose. So sometimes these dire situations, like the prison situation for me, right? Certainly, it was a challenge in my life. And you all are going through some of these challenges now. Okay, granted, it might not be as physically painful as the one I went through, but the emotion is the same. The fears, the loneliness, the frustration, the fear that you failed at something, the fear that you can't get outside that 8-foot prison cell. All of these give way to a purpose, and it's your purpose, and it's their purpose. So find the purpose and communicate that purpose and build that culture that this whole leadership conference is about, and you can come out better than ever before. Here's a statistic that I didn't tell you about. A study was done 5 years ago about all the combatants of my war, Vietnam. Nearly 2 million people were exposed to that war, and 30.6% had post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD. You know what it is? A third, nearly. Of the prisoners of war, 4% of us have PTSD. Figure that one out. And mostly the 4% are the guys who were shot down near the end of the war and were not tortured and were only prisoners for a few weeks or a month. How's that for validating my principle, okay? That challenge in your life, that adversity is a horrible thing to waste. How do you waste adversity? Blame everybody else for your problems. Feel sorry for yourself. Shower yourself with pity. Deny that you have any control of your destiny. And away goes the opportunity within that challenge. Another?
I believe that's all we have time for. Thank you very much, Captain Plum.
I'm going to be around this afternoon and tomorrow, in fact, the next day. And so I'll be padding around. If you have any questions that you know, you don't want public, grab me over a cup of coffee and we'll talk. Again, great being back at my alma mater, and great talking to this leadership conference. I got to tell you that my generation has not done a great job, and of producing leaders, and that this country, and this military, and civilian world needs leaders more now than any time I can remember. And you're it, okay? You're up to bat, right? It's the bottom of the ninth, and we're two runs behind, and you're up to bat. So you got the ball, gang. Good luck. God bless.
A small gift as a token of our appreciation. Thank you very much. We are now have a small break, and please be seated before 10:45 for our next speaker. Thank you very much.